Okay, so this is lecture number 37 of this introduction to physical metallurgy course, and today's topic is primary versus intermediate solid solution. This is the first content. So if you remember, in the previous lecture we have started a topic that is about alloys and structure of alloys, right? Not pure metal. So where we have seen that alloys are classified into three categories. First one is solid solution, second one is compound, third one is the mixture, right? Here compound and solid solution are single phase basically, but mixture is combination of phase, it is a mixture, right? And we have also classified solid solution into two categories. One is interstitial solid solution, one is substitutional, and depends upon the size of the solvent atom and solute atom, right? If there is a huge difference, it will become interstitial solid solution. If the size are comparable between solvent and solute, it will be substitution. And I have given some example: beta brass, alpha brass, right? Austenite, austenite, ferrite, sir. Which kind of solid solution? Austenite and ferrite.
Substitution.
Who is in substitution? Interstitial.
Carbon.
We are adding carbon into iron. Carbon goes into BCC iron or carbon goes into FCC iron. It is going into the voids. Octahedral voids, I told you, right? Those are interstitial sides. Okay, and alpha brass, beta brass, if you remember, this is a alloy of copper and zinc, right? Remember? Any kind of, you can mix nickel with iron, you can mix copper with nickel, you can mix aluminium and nickel, they will form this kind of solid solution, substitution solid solution. And the difference between, if somebody will ask, what is the difference between solid solution and compound? Anybody want to speak something on this? Difference between solid solution and compound. Compound always form. Compound will form when there is a reaction between solvent and solute atom, right? And they should be in a particular proportion, like Fe3C. Three atoms of iron and one atom of iron will come and react and form Fe3C. You understood my point? But solid solution have a variable composition, like nickel and copper. I can add 10% copper into 90% nickel. I can add 20% copper into 80% nickel. I can add 30% copper into 70% nickel. It will form solid solution. Composition is variable. In solid solution, you can vary the composition, right? But it should get soluble, not react. It is okay. But in case of compound, it will react and it will remain in a particular proportion. Like H2O is a compound. Two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen comes and it reacts and form H2O. But it is a liquid, it is not a solid. Anyways, and also we have discussed about that is ordered substitutional solid solution and disorder. Anybody remember? Ordered and disorder? I want an answer from the last bench. Yes, ordered and disordered, what is the difference? I think you can answer. You are answering. Nobody remember ordered and disordered?
One atom.
The best example I have given you is beta brass. Right? Beta brass, you remember beta brass is a combination of 50 atomic percent copper and 50 atomic percent zinc. Right? And zinc is what? HCP, right? And copper is FCC, right? But in beta brass, which kind of structure will form when it forms a solution? It forms either BCC or either CSCL. You forget everything, right? either cesium chloride or either BCC. If it is disordered, it forms BCC or cesium chloride. It is BCC. If it is ordered, it is which one?
BCC.
It is cesium chloride. And it is disordered, it is BCC. Ordered means what exactly? That means specific sites will be occupied, specific lattice points will be occupied by one kind of atom, and the kind of atom will occupy another specific sites. Right? Like copper is occupying suppose corner positions. The zinc will occupy only the face center positions. Or it is BCC means body center positions, obviously. That is ordered. Disordered means both will occupy random. Corner positions will occupy by copper and zinc. Body center will be occupied by copper and zinc. That is disordered, that is. And that is actually BCC. Right? Okay, anyways, we discussed a lot of things, but today we discuss about primary and intermediate. This is SSS means substitution of solid solution. Fine? The best example I can give you is same, beta brown. Writing over here, beta brown. This color is okay with everyone? Beta brown, it is, I told one, 50 atomic percent copper plus 50 atomic percent zinc, right? This is what? FCC. This is FCP. And they are now forming a solution. Solution means they will dissolve. When you add, they will get dissolved. Solid, right? So when they will form a solution, they will form either what? I told BCC or CSCL. And CSCL, this is ordered. And this is disordered. Or random. This is ordered solution, this is disordered solution, right? Is different from either of the components, either of the solvent or solute. It's okay. So this kind of solid solution is called intermediate solid solution. It's okay. The best example of intermediate solid solution. That means intermediate solid solutions are those solid solutions whose crystal structure is different from the solvent and from the solute. Because suppose this is solvent, this is solute. This is FCC, this is FCP, but this is completely different. So can you guess what is primary then? Just suppose it. Very good. That means in case of primary solid solutions, the solution structure will be either of one of the component. It is okay? Like best example is alpha brass, I told you, right? You remember the example of alpha brass? Alpha brass. Alpha brass basically it is zinc in copper will be less than 37% alpha brass, right? Again you can see copper is FCC and zinc is HCP, and a solution form, substitutional solid solution form, its structure is, anybody remember what is structure of alpha brass? Very good. So now just have a look. the solution structure is same as that of copper. Is it okay? So this is your primary substitutional solid solution. This one is your intermediate. Okay, this is done. Any confusion you have? That means when you are mixing two elements and they are forming a solution, if its structure is same to any of the component, any either with the solvent or either with the solute, then it becomes primary. If it is completely different from the solute and solvent, it is intermediate. The very simple things, right? Example is this one. So alpha brass is actually a primary solid solution, substitutional solid solution, and beta brass is an example of intermediate substitutional solid solution. Okay. Next. Next one is solubility limit. Solubility limit. So this is for interstitial So now the question is, can we add lot of solute into the parent lattice, right, to the solvent, and solvent will accommodate all the solute or not? The answer is
no.
No, it is not possible. But there is an exception. I told copper and nickel system. You can add any amount of copper into nickel. You can add any amount of nickel into copper. All will get soluble, right? And that system is called
isomorphous
system, right? 100% solid solubility and 100% liquid solubility, right? Copper is completely soluble in nickel in liquid state, and copper is completely soluble in nickel in solid state also. You cannot differentiate where copper is, where nickel is. But for every case, it is not same, right? So there is a limit of solubility. That means if you want to add solute into the solvent will not accommodate all the solute, right? Something will get soluble, other thing will get rejected. Either it may form compound or it may get rejected completely, right? So there is a limit to solubility. So first topic is, in case of interstitial solid solution, what is the solubility limit? The best example is, we are adding carbon into iron. Carbon is going into the interstitial voids, octahedral voids. It is getting soluble. But if you add more carbon, the iron will not accommodate lot of carbon. It will reject, right? It may form compound like Fe3C, but it will not make the carbon soluble, right? You understand? So there is a limit of solubility, right? So the first factor is, that is called geometric factor. Geometric factor limit. What exactly it means? Suppose big atoms are the solvent atoms and small are the solutes. So suppose this is carbon and this is iron, right? That means we are adding carbon into the iron and carbon is going into the octahedral voids or the interstitial sites. So just have a look, and can you tell me if I will add more carbon, shall it go into the voids? It is clearly visible. If you add more carbon into this iron lattice, shall it go? Shall the iron will accommodate more carbon? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. You can see these voids are visible. So more, that means if you add more carbon, it will go here, will go here, right?
Done. That means no more voids are now available. So if you add more carbon now, there will be no solubility. Already all the voids are filled. So that means, yeah.
ये जो कार्बन हम लोग ऐड कर रहे हैं ये ऑक्टेटल वर्ल्ड में जा रहा है, तो अगर और कार्बन ऐड करेंगे और टेट्राहेड्रल वर्ल्ड
में नो इट विल नॉट हैपन. एज आई टोल्ड साइज ऑफ द ऑक्टेटल वर्ल्ड इज बिगर कंपेयर टू द साइज ऑफ टेट्राहेड्रल वर्ल्ड. सो हाउ इट विल गो, इट विल गो टू ए साइज वेयर इट कैन बी अकोमोडेटेड इजीली. यू अंडरस्टैंड माय पॉइंट? लेकिन
अगर अंदर भी है तो एक्सपेंड तो कर जाएगा
ना, तो उसमें तो दैट इज एन इशू. आई विल डिस्कस दैट. So you understood my point? This is called geometric factor limit. That means when we are adding a solute into the solvent lattice, if voids are available, then the solute will get accommodated. If the voids are filled, it cannot accommodate for the solutes. It will get rejected. So that is one point. So geometric factor depends upon what? Availability of the voids or availability of the interstitial sites. Yes or no? This is done? Any confusion you have? But this is not true. This is not true. That means, for example, let me give an example. Anybody remember, if you have iron in FCC structure, that is austenite, how many octahedral voids you have per each iron atom? My question was, for each iron atom, how many octahedral void will be available in FCC iron or in austenite? Recently we have given the mid-semester examination, right?
One.
Four. Are you sure about that?
One.
For each iron atom, I am talking about. Each iron atom.
The atom by
13. Recently you have attended the mid-semester, no? You might know how many voids. Each carbon, for each iron atom. For each iron atom, how many voids? It is one. How? We have 4 effective number of atoms per unit cell in FCC, and 4 octahedral voids are there. So for 4 it is 4, for 1 it is 1. Very simple answer. You got the answer? What is the FCC iron? Per unit cell of FCC, how it will be? 1/8 into 8 plus 1/2 into 6. It will be? Yes or no? This is the effective number of atoms per unit cell. Atoms are at the corners, atoms are at the face centers. Corner contribution will be 1/8 into 8, because 8 atoms at the corner and one atom is distributed by or contributed by 8 number of unit cells. So 1/8 into 8, and each face is, that means 2 faces having one atom. Yes or no? Right. So it is half into 6 number of faces we have. So effective number of atoms per unit cell is 4. And how many octahedral voids? How to calculate?
How many octahedral voids? Do you remember how many octahedral voids? It is 4, but how?
See, you have to see the position of octahedral void in the unit cell. The first position will be the center of the unit cell, yes or no? How octahedral voids form? It is formed between 6 atoms. 6 atoms, right? Either you take 3 and you take 3. Or you can do what? You take in one plane, you take 4 atoms, you place one atom on the top, one atom at the bottom. Right? Either you take 3 and 3, it will be 6. or you take in one plane you take four atoms, and on the top you take one atom and at the bottom you take one atom. So six again, four, five and six, right? So in the FCC, the center, body center position is one of the octahedral void, right?
So body center position will give you.
And now, what are the other positions of octahedral void in FCC? Is the edge center, center of the each edge, right? So we have how many edges? 12 edges in a cube. We have 12 number of edges, right? Yes or no?
Yes.
12 number of edges, right? So total edge is 12, right? And each edge is the atoms on the each center edge will be contributed by how many edges?
Four.
Four. Each, right? The atoms which is at the edge center will be shared by the four edges or four unit cells. So it will be how much? 1 by 4 into 12. 3? Yes or no? This is the sharing of the edge center atom by 4 unit cells. So 1 by 4, and we have total 12 edges. So 1 by 4 into 12, it is coming out 3. So this is 3, this is 1. So how much? 4 octahedral points. Very simple. Yes or no? Yes or no? Right?
Yes, sir.
So if we have 4 effective number of atoms per unit cell and we have 4 number of octahedral void per unit cell, so for one iron atom it will be 1. So for each iron atom we have 1 octahedral void. It is okay now? So can you tell me if this is the situation, if in FCC iron we have 1 octahedral void for 1 iron atom, so how much carbon it can accommodate? 50? 50 or not? 50% is? Obviously 50% is,
huh? No, sir.
No, how much? 50% is, you can just imagine how it will be, right? So that means iron in FCC can accommodate 50% of carbon, but in the real situation does it happen? Never. If you calculate how much maximum weight percentage of iron can be accommodated by FCC or austenite, it is 2.1 weight percentage. Just have a look at the iron carbon phase diagram. Maximum solubility of carbon in austenite phase, it is 2.1. just have a look. If you calculate in form of atomic percentage, it will be more, somewhat. Just check the iron carbon phase diagram, you will get the answer. Right? Maximum solubility of carbon in austenite, 2.1 weight percentage. You can check the eutectoid reaction otherwise. Gamma decomposed into alpha plus cementite. Gamma is having how much? 2.1? Yes or no? Right? So, according to this geometric factor, we are saying that iron when remain in FCC can accommodate 50% of carbon. But in the real situation, it is very less. In weight percentage, it is coming out 2.1. Maybe in atomic percentage, it may be 4.3 or like that. Maybe. I don't remember exact figure. That means it is very less. Obviously, it is very less. The 50%, where 50% is, where only 2.1 or 4.3% is, right? So, what may be the reason? So, next reason comes into play, that is your second line. That is lies in the answer lies what happened when the carbon is going into the iron. What happens to the lattice? Lattice get expanded. You remember? Why? Distorted, yes. Because the size of carbon atom is bigger, but size of the interstitial void is smaller. Not so small. Comparable, but smaller. Right? If something is going into a void and it is small in size, so there will be a misfit. Misfit will be there, no? Carbon should not fit, but it is intentionally going into the void. So there will be a misfit. If there will be a misfit, it leads to the expansion of the lattice. Lattice will get expanded because the carbon atom will push the iron atoms. It is okay? So due to this misfit, there will be a distortion of the lattice, or lattice get expanded in other way you can say, right? So due to this, what will happen? The strain energy will increase. The energy of the lattice will increase. That is called strain energy increases, right? So you can write that is called lattice strain energy. So what I can write? I can write carbon, okay. I can write radius of the carbon is greater than radius of the octahedral coil, right? Okay? So that means what? There will be a misfit. Yes? If this, there will be a misfit, what will happen? Or strain in the lattice increases, or lattice strain increases, or strain in the lattice increases, right? And when strain will increase, what will happen? Energy will increase. And you understand, a lattice never wants to be in a strain, or it never wants to be in a high strain energy, right? Like free energy. Always any material or any lattice want to have a low free energy, right? Similarly, a lattice always wants to be in a low strain energy, right? But due to... Okay, this way.